I'm tired, really tired of being told by virtually every religion, in both subtle and powerful ways, that humanity must suffer. Founders of religion, religious texts, commentaries on religious texts, and the current... all bring this cross-cultural message. To be human is to suffer. And to suffer is an important step in connecting you with God, or gods, God's messengers, the circle of life, your community, and your faith. This elevation of suffering to where the word becomes part of who we are supposed to be, to me, personally, in my humble opinion, is the zenith of Norwegian sociologist Johan Galtung's triangle of structural, cultural, and direct violence. First, let's start with the word suffering. I don't know what the subtle shades of this word mean in other languages, but as translated into English, there are 1,430 synonyms, each carrying an array of values. Suffering in a religious context doesn't clearly describe what kind or level your pain must be to warrant the word suffering. I mean, there's pain of pricking your finger with a sewing needle and the pain of first love. There's the pain of having the flu or the pain of having cancer. There's the pain of giving birth to a child, and there is the pain of seeing that child die, and so on. As a child, though, I only knew one meaning for suffering, and that was mental and physical anguish without end, without much hope, brought on by horrific diseases or by other people with evil intentions. And it would terrify me when my Welsh fire and brimstone preacher would say, "Jesus said, suffer the little children to come to me." In my mind, that meant to be with nice Mr. Jesus. I had to get cancer like my grandma, or do a death march, then be a POW under Japanese occupation, like a family friend. Another suffering angle I was told was that God sometimes allows Christians and others to suffer in order that they might learn the secret of obedience. As a teenager during the feminist era of the early 1970s, this never sat well. I thought, am I supposed to be obedient when I see something is wrong in the world? What about see something, say something? If I stay conditioned to say nothing, am I fully human? Early on, the Torah, Old Testament, states that suffering is a characteristic of the human existence. Before Genesis mentions love or peace or the indomitable human spirit, it tells us we come from dust and we will return to dust. Genesis tells us that God thought land, sea, light, ocean creatures, animals, and man were good, and that he was pleased with himself for his handiwork. The written word never says he explicitly loves his human creations, and when they disobey, he punishes them in a significantly harsh way. And through terrible punishment, we are meant to learn how to be good. 16 sentences after the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve come together to have Cain and Abel. And note, there are no words of love, commitment, or family. Instead, we get blood offerings, which God loves, and offerings of fruit, to which he gives no regard. In quick succession, there's an ultimatum, which is met with anger, jealousy, murder, lying, being cursed, punishment, vengeance, and banishment. The first time we read the word love is when God asks Abraham to take his beloved only child, kill him for a burnt offering in Genesis 22. Yikes! To me, the God of the Old Testament seemed very, very odd. In the New Testament, Jesus tells us God will strengthen us, uphold us, help us, and be with us. And then 3 years later, God orchestrates a cruel death for his only begotten son, which I have always had trouble connecting with parental love. God's methodology for all this was to help us be in fellowship with Jesus' suffering, so we too could attain resurrection from the dead. In Islam, Muhammad repeats Jesus' message to love one another. Yet for the last 10 years of his life, when Muhammad couldn't negotiate with those who stood in his way, he turned to a military life and led caravan raids and battles leading to the deaths of over 1,000 people. So this very holy man, who taught of one God, charity, angels, and that human pride could only be balanced by obedience to God, turned out to not practice nonviolence. Love one another, yet kill if you get frustrated? It's a broken record of kings, princes, usurpers, tyrants, and all sorts of religious nuts. I am not all right with anyone who claims killing for their religion is justifiable. I'm looking at you, Joshua, Pope Julius II, the incident in Utah, Guru Hargobind, Buddhist warrior monks, and too many more. With Buddhism, the first of the Four Noble Truths is life is full of suffering. We suffer because we desire, thirst, and crave. But the Buddha says suffering can be extinguished if we abandon the idea of self, and we can eliminate self through the eight right paths. Nevertheless, we will suffer for a long time. This has been, for far too long, the starting lesson of life. From infancy around the world, we are told that life is suffering, and there is no way around it because the only way to heaven or nirvana or to be reincarnated is through suffering. Too many of us believe that we are not worthy of our precious life here on this earth, and certainly not in the next, unless we have long bouts of pain. Beyond adversity, anguish, distress, difficulty, discomfort, grieving, hardship, misfortune, and illness. No, to qualify as real suffering, we must have all of the above, but preferably unceasing torment with hardly the possibility of relief. Why would we want to believe that suffering is demanded from a loving God? Why would we want to make it a test of how the believer will endure with patience and trust in Allah's mercy? They have been taught by their clergy that to suffer greatly reaps great rewards. In order to achieve these lofty ideals of suffering, sometimes we have an ugly history of self-inflicted pain. Why does this happen? Does the drama of turning everyday woes into fodder for prayers answer some deep need in our psyche? Or is it all man-made to make us keep coming to religion for communal fever? Despite what you may think, it's a fact that we are living in the most peaceful time in history. Look it up. It is true that, for many, suffering is a real thing, but it's the kind of suffering that we cannot begin to imagine if we have food and shelter, safety, and people who love us. The song says, "I hope you dance," not "I hope you suffer" or "I hope you know suffering." That kind of rhetoric leads to structural violence, cultural violence, and direct violence. And like an iceberg, most of it lies deep and dark. If I were going to start my own religion, it would be about the joy of connection, the comfort of people we cherish, justice, freedom, and kindness. At the end of my life, I don't want to be tired from years of suffering, but from a life fully lived, with a full heart and an all too human soul.